Today, I will explain you what is exactly behind the statistical tests in Monolix and how to use them. I'm using the referring covariate 1 project from the demos, which is a simple PK dataset. Weight, sex, and age have been tagged as covariates and are not yet included in the model. The tests are displayed in the tab Result Tests. They are calculated at the same time as the task conditional distribution, so you need to run this task first in order to see the tests. They are complementary to the diagnostic plots, so let's first have a look at the plots. I'm looking at the plot of the random effects versus the covariates, and here we see a pretty clear trend between the random effects of the volume and the weight, which suggests to add weight as a covariate on the volume. However, if my dataset would contain much less individuals, as in this example, the slope might be as steep as before, but because of the fewer individuals, I would be less confident that the volume is really correlated to the weight. To help you decipher when this trend is significant, taking into account the slope, meaning the correlation coefficient, as well as the number of individuals, we have the test section. For continuous covariates, such as weight, we perform a Pearson correlation test between the covariate and the random effects. We do so for each pair of covariate and random effect, independently of the other random effects and covariates. The resulting p-values are displayed here. The null hypothesis of the Pearson correlation test is that the correlation coefficient is equal to zero. So a small p-value means that the Pearson correlation coefficient is different significantly from zero. This takes into account the correlation coefficient itself, but also the number of individuals via the degrees of freedom of the t-distribution. The eta values used for the test are calculated using the individual parameters sampled from the conditional distribution, not the EBEs, to ensure unbiased tests. To learn more about the conditional distribution, please have a look at the feature of the week video number 6. These sampled values can be seen in the plots if I have chosen the default option conditional distribution. And what you can see is that I have several values per individual. When doing the Pearson correlation test, we need to take into account that the several samples for one individual are not independent, they are correlated. For the Pearson correlation test between etas and covariates, it can be shown mathematically that we can use the average over these samples to do the test. So this was for the continuous covariates. For the categorical covariates, such as sex, the procedure is similar, except that we perform an ANOVA to test if the mean of etas for each category are equal. A small p-value indicates that all means are not equal, meaning that the etas of at least one category have an average significantly different from the others. To help you spot the small p-values, we highlight them with a yellow, orange, and red color code. Of course, this is only statistics, and before including a covariate, its physiological plausibility should also be considered. So this was for the covariates. We also have the same type of tests for the random effects. First, we test that the random effects are normally distributed. This is complementary to the plot distribution of the random effects. It can help to detect that the parameter distribution we have assumed here is not well suited. More specifically, the null hypothesis is that the random effects are normally distributed. The test is a Shapiro-Wilk test. In this case, it is not possible to average the values over the replicates, so the test is performed for each replicate, meaning that we take all first samples of all individuals, do the test, then take all second samples for all individuals, do the test, etc. This leads to several p-values, and we apply the Benjamini-Hochberg correction to get only one final p-value. The next test is displayed below. It tests for the correlation for each pair of random effects in complement to the plot correlation between random effects. These tests are particularly useful to choose which correlation should be estimated as part of the population parameters. The null hypothesis of this test is that the expectation of the product of the random effects for the first and second tested parameter is zero, and this is tested using a t-test. In the next tab, individual parameters, we test if the transformed individual parameters are normally distributed. If no covariates are included, the test is the same as for the random effects, but this is not the case anymore when covariates are present in the model. The null hypothesis is that the transformed individual parameters are normally distributed, and again, this is tested with a Shapiro-Wilk test on each replicate plus the Benjamin-Hochberg correction. The last tab is for the residuals. First, we test if they are symmetrical around zero, and then if they are normally distributed. For the symmetry, we use the Mayo-Gell and Gastwitz symmetry test that tests if the median of the residuals is equal to its mean, and for the normality of the residual, it's again the Shapiro-Wilk test. Note that the p-values in these sections are not color highlighted because deviation from symmetry or normality is hard to interpret and to fix for the residuals. Now let's see what changes when covariates and correlations are added to the model. According to the p-values, I will add weight on the volume and add a correlation between V and CL. I go back to the statistical model tab, first log transform weight, add it on the volume and add a correlation between the volume and the clearance and run again. After running, in the result test, I have a new section that has appeared, which tests the correlation between the parameter, not the random effect, and the covariate. A small p-value indicates a strong correlation. If the p-value would be high, it would mean that I actually don't have a significant correlation between the covariate and the parameter on which I have added the covariate. A high p-value would be highlighted in color to indicate that one may want to remove it from the model. The logic of the color code is always to highlight things that may need to be modified. Below, we perform a val test, which tests if the estimated beta parameter is significantly different from zero. If the p-value is small, then it means that the beta is significantly different from zero, meaning that the covariate has an impact on the parameter. This is what we want, so the small p-value stays black. Be careful that contrary to the other test, the val test requires to run the task standard errors. In the random effects versus covariates, parameters already included as covariates are highlighted in blue. If you remember the previous run, we also had a small p-value between sex and volume. Now that I have added log weight on the volume, this correlation between sex and volume has disappeared. This is because the effect of sex was not directly about sex, but rather related to the difference of weight between males and females. In this section, I can also spot the remaining covariates that may be added to the model, for instance, the weight on the clearance. Now let's check the random effects. Here, again, random effects for which a correlation is already included in the model are shown in blue. The p-value is pretty high, and it is colored in red because this contradicts the model hypothesis of a correlation between volume and clearance. In the individual parameters, parameters without covariates are still tested for normality using Shapiro-Wilk, and for parameters with covariates, we now perform a Kolmogorov-Smirnov adequacy test. To conclude, the diagnostic tests complement the diagnostic plots and guide the user to improve the model. The color code allows to easily detect the model elements that could be improved from a statistical point of view. Because the tests are based on the samples from the conditional distribution, they are very reliable. And finally, note that each test is done independently of the other tests, so this means that if a dataset have both, for instance, weight and body mass index, both might be highlighted as significantly correlated to the volume, but only one needs to be added to the model as they carry redundant information. We will see in the next video how to tackle this. If you would like to know more about the tests, you can go to our online documentation where all test statistics and procedures are detailed. Have a nice week!